Yo, everybody, welcome to the ZLGNF channel. My name is Zay, and today we're doing something a little different. And what is that? Well, I'm talking about Attack on Titan, which is not different at all, actually. That's just what I usually do. But as you can see, I'm recording this vlog style. Why am I doing that? I don't fucking know, man. I just wanted to do something a little different, I guess. You know, my channel's dying. I guess I should make something interesting. Is this interesting? Me doing this? Maybe. I don't know. Before I actually do something interesting, I'll do this instead. So what am I doing? Dan in the comments in my last video talked about how it was interesting maybe to see my thoughts and on the stuff that's going on. And I was like, yeah, maybe that is interesting, you know, because every time I try to go into a deep rant about whatever, I always get sidetracked in the live stream, you know, because I'm reading the comments and I'm too ADHD, honestly. So instead, let's focus a little bit and just talk about like random events, which is going to be impossible because I don't have like any notes. So I'm just going to go off and talk about whatever. So here we go. I guess let's just ramble about the rumbling. Okay, so number one, the rumbling is happening right now in the story. I thought that was the ending of the story. I thought that was going to be the point. If they say I'm amongst a The Mist type of ending, I thought that the rumbling happening and humanity not learning how to avoid this kind of shit, that's the end of the cycle of oppression, is that we ultimately just end all of us. I thought that was the perfectly type of cruel stuff that Isayama said. He wanted to hurt us, and I think that was kind of like where he was going with this. I want to remind you guys, at the time that I was still making videos, you know, and not being a fucking dead channel, at that time there was the whole Attack on Titan, the final exhibition. There was like something about the sounds of the final chapter. That was before the rumbling happened, and then it did, and it was like, yeah, like that sound was the fucking rumbling. It was not shocking that it happened. It sucks to see though, right? Like, it sucks to see Eren Yeager doing that stuff, but it was inevitable, right? And the more we learn about the story and the nature of the Attack Titan, the more it was like, it was definitely gonna happen. Now, I am relieved that the story is actually not over, because I am enjoying the drama with the characters learning that they are the benefactors of this shit, that they are benefiting from this genocide, and they probably shouldn't try to stop it. If they want easy lives, if they want to live, if they want to have it nice and easy, they should just let this shit happen. And I enjoy the drama of them learning that and coming to terms to like, this is still not okay, and we still gotta fucking fight this. And I loved seeing the other side, people like Flock and Samwell and Das coming back, and knowing that if somehow the rumbling stopped, Paradi is fucked, and we need to fight these fucking cringevengers that want to save the world. Who the fuck are these idiots? Everything about that was awesome, was fascinating. The drama is juicy, is palpable, is real. If you stop this genocide, the next one is gonna happen, and it's gonna be on your ass. I also really enjoyed it. Well, maybe this word is a little heavy, but like, I liked how Isayama didn't shy away from showing the other countries, and specifically little children, kids, just suffering because of the genocide, because of the rumbling. It's horrifying. That panel with Ramsey being crushed, I'm gonna be remembering that every time I close my eyes. You know, it's kind of like a Junji Ito iconic panel. I'm putting it like way up there because I keep remembering that face. I didn't need to see this, right? I knew genocide was bad immediately, but some people did. Some people look at Eren's actions and are like, yo, this guy's fucking Chad. This guy's an alpha. Let's fucking go. And maybe that will actually help them think a little bit differently. Or maybe not. I've learned that a lot of people still think that Eren is in the right, that this is the only way they could have survived. That's certainly the way the author wants us to think. Isayama wants us to believe that it's kill or be killed, do genocide or suffer genocide. I was sending a friend of mine a meme, some kids in college taking a class called Freedom 101. The topic was like why Eren was right. My friend was like, yeah, I don't know, man. If I had to choose between do genocide or suffer genocide, I guess I'd rather do the genocide. And I was like, I don't think I can agree with that. I wouldn't be able to live with myself. I would rather fucking die. But I'm biased, you know, my life fucking sucks. Again, my YouTube channel's fucking dying, and you know, I'm stuck in a dead-end job, so might not be the most qualified person. I'm a little biased in terms of, like, not minding dying. Some people actually want to live. Willie Tiber wanted to live. Eventually, at the end, I'll talk about that guy a little later, I guess. But I think that overall, I rather die, not because I'm fucking depressed, but kind of am, but because I rather stay too true what I really am. The world is getting so bad, so rough. Politicians are so fucking comfortable in saying shit like transgenderism needs to be eradicated. I don't know about you, but in my language, that means they should be genocided. And when you say this and people are clapping for you, that's horrifying. And that reminds me of like, what is the right thing to do? What's the wrong thing to do? I'm not gonna tell you you're transphobic for playing Hogwarts Legacy, but you know, maybe you should think twice about that kind of stuff, you know? Anyway, back to Attack on Titan. Isayama definitely wants us to think it's those choices and there's no middle ground. And if there was any kind of middle ground, Eren Yeager with the Attack Titan seeing the future make this happen. Maybe, potentially, again, I haven't finished the story. I don't know the true extent of the abilities of the Attack Titan, how that future stuff might work. Is it just sending memories and people choose their actions based on what they're seeing? And that choosing is not really choosing. It was always part of this weird destiny. The past, present, the future are all happens and have happened at the same time, you know? Forgot to say this, but like, I'm half expecting some kind of reveal about the Attack Titan actually manipulating people's brains, like brainwashing them into doing certain actions, because we keep coming back to the Eren little kid killing the two adults that were kidnapping Mikasa. It was actually three, the third one Mikasa killed. But you know what I'm talking about, right? Like he made like makeshift weapons. Also, more importantly than that, he just found where Mikasa was, because those guys were not in Mikasa's house. Eren and Grisha went there and they were like, oh shit, Mikasa's gone. And Eren just knew where to go and then made makeshift weapons. And I'm just like, bro, as a 9-year-old, I couldn't wipe my own ass correctly. Okay, like, it's kind of an issue, but but you know what I mean? Like, he just did. And I'm half expecting, you know, there'd be a reveal of future Eren, like, manipulated young Eren. We just keep coming back to that scene, both in the manga and then the anime, with the opening, and the ED also adds that scene. And I'm just like, It can't be a coincidence, you know what I mean? Like, it can't be a coincidence that we keep seeing the race chapel when Eren is talking to Zeke. It's just a random panel. Oh shit, it was actually, like, the biggest fucking deal ever. Oh shit, there's birds now. I think birds now are fucking important. I'm not gonna read the whole manga looking for fucking birds, but like, when Armin and Annie are talking and there's like a just huge shot and close up on this bird eye, and I'm like, Sama, what the fuck? Because the ED also had these birds, and I'm just, that's another thing. And I'm also expecting flowers to be important. Am I the only one that cares about fucking flowers here? Like, what the fuck's going on?
Eren Yeager saw the future, and initially he didn't like it, and he tried to explore every other option possible. And eventually, he comes at a point where you either choose the future that you saw. That is, number one, it's horrifying. But number two, the people that you care about, they're alive. Sorry, Sasha. And you gotta make a decision. You choose the guaranteed path that you know, for the most part, people are alive. Or second option is the big unknown. Who knows what the fuck's gonna happen here? If Eren didn't decide to do the rumbling, if they tried to come up with other solutions, if Sam wants to tell us nobody had any fucking plans, and I'm looking at the story, and I'm just like, I don't know, man, fucking like, talk to Willie Tiber or something. You know, that guy that has the power, the charisma, the money, and the knowledge to get other people from other countries to listen to the true history of the people in Paradis, and specifically the King of the Walls. Maybe if we reached out to this guy, maybe things could have been different. He didn't want to help aliens, and that guy is a fucking villain for that. But maybe we could have reached that guy. I don't know. I'm just spitballing here. Maybe a small-scale rumbling would have been the best solution. Story would probably have to crank out babies, but maybe it wouldn't have to necessarily become the Beast Titan. Eren Yeager doesn't want to risk it. He has the guarantee, and he has this path where anything can happen. Maybe everybody could live. Maybe Sasha could live as well. But it's also very likely that all of them could die. And he doesn't want this. This is a risk, and this path that he saw in the future is a guarantee. He chose this path that was secure. So, because of that, both the story itself with the character's actions, but also, like, I feel like Isayama's hand is also in here just trying to force us into this one situation. Like, is the rumbling truly inevitable? With something like the Attack Titan?
Yeah, it was. But can you guys come up with other solutions? I actually am curious, you know? I'm tired of this fucking kill or be killed kind of shit, and I would rather listen to something else.
On the same topic of Eren Yeager, I also to reiterate how I'm just confused by this character, just in terms of how the same person looks at the future and he's like, oh god, this is bad, but then later he's talking to Zeke and he's like, I don't know, man, I saw that view, it was pretty cool. And it's just like, how can you have these two different reactions? I know that the view, technically a kid Eren saw it, so maybe that's why he likes the view. I like to believe that the guy that was in Liberio talking to Ramsay, that's the real Eren, that's the Eren from season 3, that's the Eren that I like, and that's the Eren that knows that this shit is wrong and grew to be a little bit more compassionate, and he doesn't want to be defended, doesn't want you to be like, oh, he was right, because he himself agrees that it's fucking wrong and he's not enjoying the things that he's doing. But then you have times where he's saying shit like, I've always been like this, if you take my freedom I'm gonna take yours, and I'm just like, bro, were you like that? I have a hard time believing that you were like that. And keeping that train going of not understanding Eren's actions, I'm also a little confused with the story. When we got chapter 130 and you have finally, after fucking years of waiting, the scene where Historia is
talking. Whoa, she's talking. This woman can talk, bro. She's not an object. Well, consider me shocked, because the way she was treated in this fucking arc has been disgusting. I'm just gonna say it right now, because I don't think we're gonna get more with her. And if we get more, I don't think it's gonna be good. It's gonna be worth it. Hopefully I'm fucking wrong. I want to be wrong. But right now, I'm completely and utterly disgusted with the way Astoria has been written in this arc. Everything that she represented is like fucking just gone. It's like so discarded. Like, she is not who she was. When you have the scene where Eren reveals his plan and she's horrified, and then Eren has to be like, ah, but Astoria, do you remember season 3? And she's like, oh yeah, I do. I guess I killed them all. like what? So let's actually go back to season 3. Now, I could be wrong. That's the way I interpret this fucking scene. We're talking about the scene in the Race Chapel. Eren is fucking crying, begging Astoria to eat his ass. Not literally. I don't think Eren's the dad. And at this point, I hope not. I want Mikasa and Astoria to be as far away as possible from fucking Eren Yeager. But yeah, like, in the Race Chapter, Rob was, like, manipulating her. And initially, she's like, maybe. But eventually, she thinks about Ymir. She said, I want you to live your life with pride. That's the words that she left behind to Astoria. And Astoria, in that moment, thinks about that and makes a decision that she's proud of. Not a decision without regrets. That's Levi's thing. But a decision that she can make. That she's proud, that she owns as her own decision and not somebody else's that is forcing on her. Anyway, she saves Eren because she sees herself in Eren. Eren is crying, doesn't want to live just like Astoria did, and she's following the footsteps of Ymir and Freyda, and she wants to be like them. And she makes a decision and she yells, I'm the worst girl, fuck humanity, because all I want to do at this point is save this fucking guy, right? It's positive. But Eren turns this around and it's like, you said you didn't like humanity back then, you were willing to make sacrifices because you're selfish. I think you're gonna do this plan that I'm telling you right now. And Astoria, to me, doesn't feel like a selfish person. Not really. She just makes the choices that she wants to make, that she believes in, that she's proud of. And something like the rumbling doesn't seem like something that she's proud of. This is the girl that immediately after becoming a queen, she's building a fucking orphanage for these little kids that need them. And she spends all of her time there. That's Astoria. So when she's like aligning with Eren in this plan, and the justification is, ah, but you said screw humanity, I'm just like, I guess. It's realistic that she initially is like opposing that. But I find it weird that the logic is, oh god, this is bad. Remember season 3 though? And oh, okay, what if I get pregnant? I guess that's the choice that she makes. That's the choice that she's proud of. Getting her ass pregnant. I'm reminding you guys that this is the girl that came from a fucking an affair that Rod Rice was having with a fucking maid. She is an unwanted child. And having a past like that, you're really gonna have this girl bring another kid she doesn't necessarily want with a person that she doesn't necessarily love, either Eren or Farmer Kun. Either way, that shit is fucking gross. And I was deeply hurt when I read that chapter. It was airing at the same time the Uprising arc was starting. And I was just like, this is so gross. This better be worth it. And after reading up until chapter 134, I think I'm confident in saying that Isayama is fucking gross for doing this to her and not making it worth it. I felt this whole baby drama didn't really bring anything good to the table. The conversation was disgusting. Astoria is treated like an object. She's a void. She's not even talking anymore. She has no input in the fucking story. She's not an active player. She is active in making a choice that we already know she made. Eren knew she was gonna make that choice. When Eren talks to her, he knows that the rumbling is gonna happen regardless. So it's just, I'm not a fan. I don't know. I'm just like spitballing here. I haven't read the fucking manga. Maybe there's more, but right now I've been holding my tongue for Astoria, and I think at this point, chapter 130, I think that's it. And even if there is more, I don't think I'm gonna like it. And speaking of Isayama kind of being low-key misogynistic, I am deeply afraid of what's coming with Mikasa. I'm really scared of what Isayama is gonna do. I think I'm seeing the ending of Attack on Titan. Maybe I have the Attack Titan as well. I'm seeing the future. Beep. And this bitch, maybe she will kill Eren, but she's gonna be Eren cucked for the rest of her fucking life. I'm just seeing this right now. We've had like 3 different scenes where characters are like, yo, if push comes to shove and we're in front of this fucking guy and he's killing a bunch of people, we're gonna have to kill him. Are you gonna be willing to do this, Mikasa? And she doesn't answer. Now, personally to me, I didn't like Mikasa initially in the first season. I started liking her the moment she was interacting with other characters and like learning how things are just so more difficult. When Armin and Erwin are in the Seren Bowl and Mikasa's fighting for Armin, not Eren, Armin. And I'm seeing like, oh, she actually cares about other people. That's good. But she also was convinced by Hanji to give up on Armin because Erwin was the flame of humanity, the hope of humanity. If we lose Erwin, we are fucked, bro. Who knows what's gonna happen? And Mikasa herself actually like listened and dropped her weapon. That was a great moment. And I thought that was like Mikasa is learning that there's more people at play in these decisions. Her selfish ass would have gotten the world fucking destroyed in season one. She probably would fucking allow the rumbling to happen. That's the kind of person that she was before. And maybe this Mikasa in season three, that's allowing Armin to maybe die, maybe she would do the same with Eren. And at this point of the story, she's joining the Cringe Ventures, but she's still not answering this. And I'm just like, you say I'm, But speaking of the whole Erwin and Armin situation, I like how Hanji, in her final moments, turns to Armin and she's like, I can't think of another person that represents what the Survey Corp are more than you. Which comes full circle, because before she thought that Erwin was the only thing that could be the flames of hope of humanity and whatever. Like, only he could have led all of us. But at this point, she looks at Armin and she's like, you are the definition of the Survey Corp. So you are now the Commander. I think that fits her journey. As much as Hanji likes Armin, ultimately she was for Erwin in the Bowl episodes, right? And I like that we went back to that. As for Hanji's death, though, not exactly the biggest fan. The anime made it so much better, but it felt so fucking pointless. It felt like Isayama was just like, we need someone to die. Like another one of those forced Isayama scenes that's been constantly happening in this fucking arc now. Like Zeke and Levi surviving the Thunder Spear. Hanji dies because Flock appears. Why is Flock appearing? You died before, but we need to talk about Flock again. It's good that we're wrapping up how he thinks about how Paradis needs a devil. And it's good that Hanji is there because the devil is Erwin. And in that chapter, we revealed that in this fake afterlife kind of thing, Erwin is there looking at Hanji and talking to her. And I guess that's Isayama trying to tell us that Erwin would be on the Cringe Avengers team. He would try to stop genocide. I guess I can agree. If we think about Erwin, he's ordering a lot of people to their deaths even before the suicide charge. He already had this giant mountain of corpses. He also was the guy that immediately came in and made this plan, the something-something formation plan to avoid as many deaths as possible. The coup d'etat that they did in the Uprising arc. Did I say that word correctly, by the way? He made it so that there's barely any bloodshed. That's how he sold the idea of doing that to Pixies. So I think he actually usually tries to avoid killing people. It's just that sometimes he's looking out for number one, which is himself, until he couldn't do it, until the plan really required him to die as well. So I guess, like, it's good that Erwin is on that team. I guess that's Isayama's answer for that. But I do want to say, though, I think Erwin specifically, if he was in charge, Erwin would probably sacrifice Astoria. And maybe it could have been one of those paths where a lot of people's lives could have been saved. And maybe that would have been better, because Astoria has not contributed to the story at all. And at this point, I'm just like, if Isayama's barely going to write this character, you might as well just kill her. And this sucks, because I actually like her. She's one of my favorite characters, just like Armin, just like Erwin. Well, I'm biased. I really like most of the characters of the show, and I liked Eren a lot in season 3. I didn't like him before, but I learned to really love him ever since the Race Chapel chapters where he was crying and he was like down on himself, but then he looked at Astoria and he envied her, how she was like living with pride and making choices. Like, damn bro, I wish I could be like that. Now I feel fucking worthless because I'm not fucking special. And then he talked to Keith Shadis in the Bystander chapter and he was like, maybe I am special, maybe everybody is special. And I love that, bro. And I thought he was gonna be taking that lesson this mom gave him about being special and being born into this world. He was yelling that in the first chapter of Return to Shingashina arc, and here we are. Instead of championing in life, motherfucker is championing death. So fuck Eren Yeager for committing genocide. But yeah, in terms of like predictions for the ending, besides Mikasa's gonna be cucked forever, I'm seeing a kumbaya my lord type of ending. Ever since I saw that Colonel Sanders ending racism, that's the moment I knew that we're gonna have a pretty lame ending. We're just gonna pretend that like people are okay when the end of the world is coming and people are like, maybe this is my fault. Like, what? Like, it's so ridiculous. Again, I agree, racism is fucking awful, and we need to have a speech like that. That's the message of Attack on Titan, I think. It's good to have that stuff, but my god, bro, it's not realistic to have a speech like that in a moment like that. It just isn't. Maybe it could have been realistic if it was McGough, bro. McGough, the guy that wanted to change how Marley was operating. McGough, that was the guy who was, like, actually self-aware about what was going on. It was, like, criticizing Marley to Willy. But, you know, McGough had a pretty good death anyway, but I think the speech would have been better, because I don't fucking know who this Colonel Sanders guy is. He's not even that Colonel Sanders, you know, Weiss's dad in Ruby. That guy is more of that. By the way, is anyone watching Ruby? Because right now I'm watching Volume 9, and it's, like, surprisingly okay. You know, I feel like the last seasons of Ruby have been so fucking bad. To be honest, that show's bad forever. I'm just kind of hoping it was gonna get good. I guess 10 years later, this Volume 9 is okay right now. They made the right decision, which is told the main story to fuck off and just grab the little small cast of characters that they could and threw them into another dimension. That's what's going on right now. Four characters are now depressed in another dimension. That's smart, bro. We don't need this end of the world storyline. But here comes Isayama, resolving characters having depressions on all kinds of character arcs and wrapping up a lot of shit while the world is ending. Who could have seen Karina getting like a little wrap up? Maybe Eren could because he sees the future, but I can't. I was not ready for that, but that's good. And Henny's dad is getting a lot of play. That's good. So right now I enjoy this, but there's just some stuff. I just think overall, little by little, the quality is like dropping a little bit. Am I crazy here? Not too much. But ever since the fucking Zeke and Levi Thunder Spear situation, I've been like, one, two, three, just moments and I'm like, but that's just me though. But anyway, that's it, okay? I'm sorry I'm doing a stream. I just wanted to do something different. I was walking and then I just kind of gave up. So I'm just gonna stand up here again and just say to you guys, thank you for watching this bitch. This is definitely gonna be a bitch to edit. Guys, leave a like, okay? Come on. Leave a like. Come on, bro. I'm fucking dying here. I don't know what I'm doing with my channel, but I'm kind of also excited. What happens after Attack on Titan is over? Am I gonna fucking stop making Attack on Titan videos? Probably yes, probably no. Reactions are gonna be over, but like, I really wanna talk. This video you're watching, at the top of this here, I'm seeing 35 minutes. I'm gonna edit that down as much as possible, but like, I hope you know that I can ramble on and on about this show forever. There's a lot of things I wanna say, but I still got 5 chapters ahead of me to really make my final decision. So yeah, I'm sure this is gonna be complicated for you guys to, you know, talk to me because of like information that you guys know. Be careful in the comments, don't spoil. Just like engage with what I have right now. Pretend you don't know what's coming ahead. What are your thoughts so far now that you saw Attack on Titan, the final season, the final chapters, special one? Pretend there's no more and there's gonna be more in fall. All right, that's it. Thank you for watching. This is gonna be a bitch to edit, you know. Maybe I need to practice more editing, you know, instead of like being on my lazy ass making a stream. What do you people prefer? Do you prefer streams? Do you prefer videos? I don't fucking know. Nobody's watching any of them. Fuck!
I know. You doubt I'll be in love with you myself. I told that I could live for no one else, but it's not to run the hurt and pain. It's time for me to respect.